Am I on?
Dinner just before I came, and I'm being good at the moment.
Okay, there we go. I'd like to call to order the City of Sammamish Planning Commission meeting on May 17th. It's now about 6:01. I'd like to start with approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Great. Oh, and I always do this, and I'd like to take roll call, please. I don't know why I skipped that. Sorry. Why don't we start on my right?
Joe Lipinski.
Mahbubul Islam.
Mike Luxembourg.
Kathy Richardson.
Jeff Wasserman.
Ryan Coleman.
Mike Collins. Shout out for the Sounders. Hope you come back this next Saturday.
Great. All right, since we've approved the agenda, let's go on to approval of the minutes for the April 19th and May 3rd meetings. Does everyone, do I have a motion?
So moved.
Have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. And now we'd like to review the calendar, please.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. I'm Cameron Garrell with the Community Development Department. Should have in your packet an updated calendar in our two versions. We've been looking at the vertical kind of portrait version lately because it has more detail. It shows the meeting dates for ECA through July at this point. Down at the bottom, I would note that we do have some contingency dates that we're still exploring that may be added to this calendar at some point. Tonight, we're in the second part two of the streams and wetlands section. So you'll be focusing on wetlands, wetland management areas, lake management districts tonight and making your initial recommendation. And we have a few weeks gap till June 14th, June 28th. Remember, for June and July, we've shifted from first and third Thursdays to second and fourth Thursdays. That does introduce a little gap right now. That was done deliberately for two reasons. One, we've got a holiday week at the end of May, which is a tough week for the public and for staff to actually produce materials there. We're actually running a little thin here at the city that week. And then we've got some prearranged staff absences actually in early June as well. So with the commission's permission, we shifted out those to second and fourth. I think it's actually a better calendar for us more broadly than that. There is a lot of work that's happening in the back room, you know, between meetings, not only to prepare you for meetings, but recall that you've made some decisions to advance things already. And so staff are actually now working on that material. This little window of time for the staff that are going to be here, they're going to be working on a lot of that stuff. So I think it is a workable calendar from that perspective. But we're on kind of an every 2 week schedule after that, as you can see. And at this point, showing you getting to a finish line or close to it by the end of July. As the chair and vice chair know, we are looking at potential contingency dates either in July and potentially in August. I think, Debbie, you have solicited some commissioner availability during that time, and we're starting to assemble that information. I did hear Commissioner Islam mention to me one of those in the hallway before the meeting, so we'll need to get, if you haven't told Debbie yet, please do tell her if you have time away from the city, so that we can build that in. And then we'll work with the chair and vice chair to identify some proposed dates sometime in this next week or two. So more dates will get known by everybody once we get to the June 14th meeting. And we're still working on a finish line for the city by the end of 2012. That's the calendar the council has given us to work with. Perhaps a little bit later in the evening, we can recap if we have time. The commission met with the council last week in your joint meeting and talked about calendar issues. So we're still focusing on that calendar long term, but also knowing that we've got a big lift that we're doing right now. So we're going to have to keep the council leadership, and I'm going to have to keep my supervisor, the city manager, informed as the commission goes along so that they can see how we're doing on our progress. That's the calendar report. Are there any questions or concerns? Yes, sir.
There was some discussion about a 911 meeting for a joint with the council. That's not on the work program?
It's not on the work program right now. And at this point, there, you remember at the joint meeting, we talked about a handoff date in September. We actually have already, with the city clerk, shifted off of September 11 to September 17. We will get that out in paper form shortly here, but for those of you who are really paying attention in advance, the 17th is now the date that's shown. And that was just some, again, logistical reasons that we needed to move to a different date.
Thank you.
For the commission's benefit, are we anticipating that handoff being another joint planning commission city council meeting, or is that not yet defined?
It's not absolutely written in stone yet, but I think, as you recall from the joint meeting and then from a leadership meeting that we had recently, I think that's a reasonable assumption at this point. So as you have done in the past, sometimes on simple items, the chair or vice chair do the handoff. Something like this, we may want to have a joint meeting as the mechanism to do that. Again, the council, as you recall, is interested in all of your rationale and the different things that you considered, and so that will afford an opportunity for the commission as a whole to accomplish that. Anything else on calendar right now? And Madam Chair, can I just go right into director reports?
Please.
So starting with some good news, the council adopted the home business regulations the other night. So riveting television, if you watched it on Channel 21, I'm sure. I want to thank Evan Maxim, who's also your project manager for ECA. He got the home business stuff over the finish line. Council did, as you know, need to go through some debate on a number of the issues. So they made changes probably in about six or eight major areas. I would not call any of their changes major changes. Hours of operation were debated, but ultimately stayed the same as the commission had recommended. They did introduce a few areas where they put some upper limits on, for example, the percentage of the home structure that could be devoted to the business purpose versus the home purpose, residential purpose, capped at 50%. So that's the kind of thing the council wanted to introduce, was a little more certainty, maybe a little more upper limits. So glad to know that that's done. So that's, again, thanks to the commission for your work on that. I think you really delivered a great product to them. We also had a joint meeting, as you recall, and my job was to put together a few notes. So after I'm done and you get going with Evan talking about the substance of tonight's meeting, I'm going to go back and finish those notes, and then we'll have those to hand out to everybody. The chair and vice chair have seen an advanced copy and helped me make sure those notes are accurate. So those will get distributed, and Debbie will get those posted on the web. No surprises. We're just trying to recount and recap the nature of that meeting. Trying to think if there's anything else. I think for the benefit of everybody, one other major decision, I guess, that was made at the joint meeting, which is the there was some talk about having the commission take on another major policy effort, the transportation level of service, potentially while you were still working on ECA. And I think wisely we recognize that the ECA work will consume your time in the near term. And so the council said, no, we want to have everybody focused on ECA, get that done. I introduced the notion of taking a breath and then starting work on level of service. So we don't have specific dates for that yet, but at least it will be after your handoff. So I would anticipate October or November as a kind of a start time on level of service. I think that's all I have for my report here tonight, unless there are questions.
I think Commissioner Lipinski has a question.
Yeah, on the home business code, Cameron, did they get rid of the thing about, you know, if you have a big lot, you can repair cars? What did they do with that one?
Actually, they, and Evan, you maybe need to help me or remind me here, they did disallow, introduce a series of prohibited uses. Mm-hmm. And as if I recall, car repair is in that list. So in terms of commercial car repair, that is a prohibited use. On the big lot issue, they modified the lot dimension that the commission had recommended, and I think actually made a good thing there. They introduced a kind of a dimensional requirement, adding a 100-foot circle to the size of the lot as an additional criterion that someone would need for a type 2 business. Is that accurate, Evan?
Okay. Could you explain what that means,
Cameron?
Sure. You may recall that in the old code, you used to have to have a one-acre lot for a home industry use. We changed home industry essentially into a type 2 home business. And if memory serves, I'm not sure the commission had recommended any dimensional standard for the lot size. A 20-foot setback from the use from the property edge. That was one of the areas that some council members had expressed some concern about, especially with a, and we have some of these, sort of non-traditionally configured lot. You have a very skinny lot, achieve the 20-foot setback, but because of the dimension of the lot, it actually still is potential for impacting the adjacent neighbors. So what they did was to say, was to use a tool we use else, other places in the code, which is to introduce a circular diameter of a circle that has to fit within that lot, and it's a 100-foot circle. So you're going to be dealing with larger lots generally, and not the sort of odd duck sort of skinny lots will have a harder time qualifying for something like that. I think it's actually not a bad way of doing things. We use that same lot circle technique in other places in our code today, so it's something we're familiar with administering. And I think it will be one of those things that will introduce maybe a little more certainty to the resulting code. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Any other questions? Commissioner Collins.
Back on the joint commission meeting with council, the level of service, was there any feedback on that presentation from the council?
No
I
feedback.
I know they changed the dates.
They changed the dates, yeah. And you may recall during that meeting, there were four options presented to them. My takeaway was that they did not arrive at one single option. The staff had recommended a particular option. In fact, that wasn't the one that even got seemingly the most head nods. But they actually did not arrive at a single option as a decision coming out of that meeting. And I do think my colleague Laura Philpott, our Public Works Director, will have to come back to a future council meeting to talk with them about those options again.
The reason I asked that question is that it sounded like the planning commissioners that were there were really asking for direction on what they want before they hand it to us.
Which we don't
work on A or D if they want C.
Correct. And I think that is the council's task still, is to try to get to that either one or two options to give to the commission versus all four.
Because I didn't see a time in their schedule in the next couple of months where they're going to even have time to.
I don't think it's been built in yet. So stay tuned. Those of you who watch the council process, I think we'll see something pop up there at some point. I can't predict for you when.
Thank you.
Any other questions about the director's report? Okay, seeing none, I'd like to move to the next item on the agenda, which is public comment. This would be, in particular, public comment not related to our agenda for today. So on our agenda today is discussion of wetland management areas and lake management areas. So if there's anyone that has public comment on a subject other than that, now is your opportunity. And so for public comment, we have a 7-minute time limit. Please start with your name and your address.
Yes, my name is Greg Krabby. I live at 1726 Holbrook Avenue in Everett, Washington. And I come here tonight to speak to you in regards to the best available science study of the erosion hazard overlay, which you guys will be discussing next month. I am a practicing civil engineer specializing in real estate development with 25 years of experience, 17 of those here in the Pacific Northwest. And I've been approached by several property owners and other interested parties to do kind of a review of your erosion hazard overlay and compare it to more current erosion control regulations and practices. So I've kind of assembled a team of knowledgeable folks, one gentleman specializing in erosion control and water quality treatment, and another one who's a geotechnical engineer who specializes in landslide management and slope stability. So we kind of went through and reviewed the history of the code, and the way we understand it is your current erosion hazard overlay is a modified version of a code that was written starting in 1994 by King County and adopted by King County in 1997 and then you folks adopted it when, modified it and adopted it when you incorporated. And we looked at that in light of current erosion control practices as laid out by the National Polluted Discharge Control System, NPDES, and the DOE guidelines for erosion control. And what we found was that back in 94, when this code was conceived, erosion control practices were not very well conceived, not very well implemented, and very poorly regulated or enforced, as opposed to now, where in 2003, the DOE implemented a much rigorous monitoring and regulatory program. Plus, they have, since that time, issued several detailed documents and updates to their stormwater management manuals. So what we've done here, what I've done here, is written a letter that we've all contributed to, and I just wanted to submit that tonight into the record for your benefit, and look forward to meeting with you guys here in a couple weeks.
Wonderful, thank you. Please provide your letter to Ms. Beadle.
Kathy.
Thank you. Yes, we do have a question, Commissioner Collins.
Greg, do you also have that in electronic form?
You bet.
Could you give that to Debbie, because that's our preferred way of reviewing things.
Yes.
Okay, you know, I don't have it with me electronically.
So give you an email.
Do you have an email address?
Send it to
it. Oh, very good. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone else have public comment not associated? It looks like we have a couple. Okay, go ahead.
Linda Eastlick, P.O. Box 2574, Issaquah, 98027. And I'm here to restate some of what I stated at the Joint Council PC mission meeting, but also to expand on that a bit. So please bear with me. It'll be short and brief, which I know mean the same thing. I'm not seeing and or hearing what I expected to hear and see from the consultants in regards to their best available science review. What I recall from the panel interviews is stressing the importance of mapping from the science to the recommendations. I have not seen that. I have heard the science supports buffers, and that may very well be, I don't know, because the information that's presented isn't in enough detail to inform me what an appropriate conclusion would be from that information. What I thought that we would get is some sort of a, what I call meta-analysis in my field, of the science that was studied, that says, here are the kinds of things that were studied, here are the conclusions that were reached. From those conclusions and from the information that was studied, here are our recommendations, and this is why we're making these recommendations, if it follows along the line of what's in the studies or if it diverges from that. But in those panel interviews, what I heard was we would hear a clear statement of the science and we would hear a clear statement of what was an inference or an opinion about that science. What I've heard in the presentations doesn't support what I expected to hear. Thank you.
Any questions for Ms. Eastlett? No, thank you.
Okay.
Barbara Robbie, 21421 Northeast 6th Place. I hadn't intended to speak tonight because the topic is wetlands, which doesn't directly affect me. But since someone brought up erosion control, I do have a picture here of a variance that was granted at the top of 211th Street for a lot that was previously determined by King County to be unbuildable, and City of Sammamish allowed it to be built on, denuded of the vegetation, and what you see in the picture is what the result is. So I'm asking that that be put in the record, and hopefully you'll get to see that on tonight. Would that be
tomorrow?
Okay, it'll be on your web. And I have put the information on the back, if you include that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. Good to see you.
I do have a question actually for staff related to this, Debbie, if you would take a note, and that is, could staff please provide us with the type of variance that was issued for this particular property? Thank you.
Reed Brockway, 167 East Lake Sammamish Shore Lane, Northeast. The key topic tonight is wetlands, I realize, and I'm up here now partly because the weather's been so nice, I don't feel like I live in the middle of one anymore. But I do have a follow-up to the testimony I submitted to the last two meetings, which related more to streams, and I'll be very brief. This is the only opportunity I really have to talk to you guys, which is why I'm taking advantage of it right now. You may recall that two meetings ago, I submitted in my testimony descriptions of what I call the six biggest problems with the ECA code related to streams for the most part. Four of those six issues actually got some traction. They were addressed by three of the amendments that appeared on your list last time around and were promoted for further consideration. If you're doing the math, it's four of with three amendments because two of the issues were really addressed by one of those proposed amendments. But the two other issues of the six that did not get addressed are the matter of problems with grandfathering provisions in the code and the ombudsman. Staff informs me that the grandfathering provisions are going to be addressed in the June-July timeframe, and that's fine, no issue there. Regarding the ombudsman, however, staff says that that really is beyond the scope of your mission, and I could see how that would be. Furthermore, it pertains to more than just the ECA issues. An ombudsman could serve other functions as well. In the case of the ombudsman, staff says that the Planning Commission could recommend to the City Council that the council take up that matter. And I feel very strongly that that should be done. We shouldn't just let that one fall off the radar. So I'd like to encourage council to do some follow through on that if you please would. I know from surveying a number of people that have had dealings with the city that there really is a need for that. I'd like to see that happen. It's especially important, I think, because it helps address some of the inequities that exist in our not exactly perfect ECA code. So I'd like to finish this with a question for you, if I may. Can you assure us that there will be follow-through on the matter of the ombudsman?
This is not the appropriate time for us to address that question specifically, but I think you will find through our deliberations an opportunity for us to determine whether or not that is included in what we recommend to council.
Should I bring it up again in testimony, or would that not be necessary?
You're welcome to do that. I'm not sure that it's necessary, as we have that as part of our public record and public input, and I think there are several items that perhaps fall into this list of things that we might want to recommend to council to consider.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay.
Thank you.
That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Any questions for Mr. Brockway? Wonderful. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Larry Martin. I'm a land use attorney with Davis Wright Tremaine. I work in the Bellevue office at 777 108th Avenue Northeast in Bellevue. And I'm here representing owners of about 27 acres of property upland from East Lake Sammamish Parkway, accessed at 49th Place. Some people know it as the Probst property or Probst Estates. I represent the owners of that property. The property is largely undeveloped, and I'm here to address the erosion hazard overlay issue that you will be addressing in the future. First, I want to thank you for the time you put in dealing with these regulations and the updates. It's a lot of work. It takes a lot of focus, a lot of concentration, so we do appreciate it. Here mainly to say hello, introduce myself, let you know we'll be following the process. We'll do everything we can to try to provide input and support you in that with information. Mainly, I think, just to let you know, it is a real interest, a matter of real great significant and interest to the property owners, in that the property, by and large, generally speaking, is undevelopable under the current regulations. Like the former speaker, Mr. Krabby, we do support the notion that it's time to look at what makes sense today, given all the various regulations that would apply to development, many of which didn't exist when the county first adopted this type of regulation for good reason. I think most of us that have been around a while know that, in fact, there were some bad examples of development in earlier years that certainly caused erosion problems. And so the overlay in regulation is, in a very general sense, is almost like a moratorium, essentially says don't develop because we've had a lot of problems. And then, of course, over the intervening years with the regulations that have come about to deal with problems caused by development that, frankly, some of which was irresponsible, we feel, as we all take a close look at it, we'll figure out that really don't need such a broad restriction anymore, but can rely on the new regulations, and that your overlay restriction can be loosened up or maybe even in some areas eliminated. And that process we really support and want to let you know we appreciate you looking at it, and that it does mean a lot to the owners of the property who right now really are pretty much in limbo. And as you may know, Mrs. Probst passed away some time ago, not too long ago, and the remaining owners of the property are family members that are trying to deal with that property. So again, we thank you very much and appreciate your work on it.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Do we have any questions? Commissioner Collins?
I am interested in his points of view, and I'm hoping that he'll submit written statements so that we can have it electronically in review.
I was just going to reinforce that as well. We've had a couple of new participants tonight, and I do want to remind everyone that the Commission does take the time to read the testimony that's provided in writing, and would very much encourage you following up your verbal testimony with written testimony. It's very helpful to us. Do we have anyone else that would like to speak on a subject not associated with what we're discussing tonight? Okay, seeing none, we will proceed with tonight's agenda. And what we're going to do is we're going to have staff present to us the recommendations that we are here to consider for further action as part of our process. After the staff presentation, which I understand is somewhat lengthy tonight, we have 21 recommendations to review. We will have public comment associated with the three topics for tonight. At the conclusion of public comment, then the Commission will actually review the recommendations and determine which ones should proceed and whether or not we want to propose any additional recommendations based on our review. So with that, Evan.
Thank you, Chair. Evan Maxim, one of the planners for the City of Sammamish. I've been given two directions tonight. Be very, very quick and be thorough and speak more slowly. I guess that's three directions. I'll try. So, of course, we're talking about three types of critical area features tonight. We're talking about wetlands, wetland management area overlay, and the lake management areas.
I just want to remind commissioners, if you can hold your questions to the point at which we're reviewing the recommendations, that would be very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Chair, tonight we were intending to do kind of similar to what we did our last meeting. We'll have a relatively brief presentation of the recommendations coming from the public and from the best available science reports. Try and give you a bit of a summary of what those regulations would do if they're advanced to July. We'll have the opportunity for public comment, and then I would ask the Planning Commission, after public comment is taken, to kind of give us the advance or not advance direction and identify any additional questions that you might have related to each specific recommendation. With that, as you said a moment ago, Chair, this is the second step in a two-step process. Tonight we're focusing just on these three features. You may recall back in late April we had a presentation of the best available science. This is the follow-up discussion. Looking forward just a little bit, we've already talked about this, but June 14th we're looking at the best available science presentation related to landslide hazard areas, the erosion hazard area, and the erosion hazard near sensitive water body overlay, what the two gentlemen here earlier tonight were speaking to. And we'll be doing a similar exercise to what we're doing tonight on June 28th, evaluating recommendations to move forward to our July hearing. We do have a couple items that have popped up on the resource guide. I believe they've also been updated onto the website. The comment summary matrix has been updated even through, I believe, two comments we received earlier this week. We are working on providing responses, a bit of catch-up as we go along there, but you will see a new comment summary matrix in your tab 7 of your resource guide. The recommendation memo that we talked about at our last meeting on May 3rd, memo number 2, which deals with fish and wildlife habitat, conservation areas, and the like, has been updated with just a very brief summary statement of the Planning Commission direction that we received at that meeting. I would encourage the Planning Commissioners to re-review that updated memo. If we didn't capture the Planning Commission's direction, would you mind please email me or contact me in writing at a later date, and we'll make sure we get that corrected before we get into July. You should also find a staff...
Time's up. You're done.
You weren't thorough enough.
You're done.
I was speaking too slowly, clearly. You should also find in your resource guide a staff recommendation. Staff recommendation memo number 3. That, of course, deals with the issues tonight. It is posted on our website, what we'll be covering in a moment. And then, of course, we've been updating as we move along these matrices that capture the verbal Q&A that we heard even tonight, and we'll try and provide follow-up responses as we move forward. The draft code amendments, similar to our last conversation, we are not presenting you with draft language tonight. We will prepare that as needed as we move this forward into July. We've covered the goal for tonight, so I'm just going to skip right past this slide. This is my efficiency moment. Source of the recommendations, as I mentioned, this is coming both from the best available science reports and from the public comments. I'll remind you, we actually had 2 reports. We had the one related to wetland and wetland management areas, and then a separate report which was related to the lake management areas. So consultant recommendation number 1, and this is actually mirroring some of the public comment we received as well, but this is to update our definition for wetlands. And what we would do in that update is reference the new 2010 Army Corps of Engineers manual and their supplemental regional documentation for Western Washington. We also need to update our reference to the Washington Administrative Code, the WAC, that you see referenced on the screen there, which is the new wetland definition coming out of the state. The city staff is recommending that we advance this particular recommendation. It is consistent with best available science, provides a necessary update to our regulations. Recommendation number 2 is a recommendation by the consultant that we expand, frankly, a bit of an administrative provision in our code that requires that a potential developer or builder or applicant, so to speak, evaluate all properties within 215 feet of the site where the development would occur to identify whether or not there are any wetlands, streams, or the like that could potentially affect their property. If access isn't possible, the evaluation will be done by aerial photo, best available records that might be available online. The city staff is recommending that we not advance this recommendation onto our July meeting. What we have right now in our code is authority for the city staff to require that the applicant provide that information to the maximum extent necessary to provide for an accurate critical areas review. In short, it allows the city staff discretion in evaluating whether or not truly going out 215 feet is necessary. Planning Commission may recall that 215 feet really only picks up the Category 1 bog wetland buffers. Those are relatively rare in Sammamish, and they're pretty well known by the city staff that you have working on this type of project. Requiring a 215-foot scope for evaluation every single time is frankly going to be overkill when we're doing our development review. And of course, here on the screen, I've summarized what I just said. Recommendation 3 is to look at providing for a fee in lieu mitigation program for wetland impacts. Planning Commission will recall that we did talk about this in our meeting on May 3rd, related to stream fee in lieu mitigation programs. We have the same type of locational requirement for wetlands and streams. If you do have to do mitigation, our preference would be to do it on-site on the same property. Then we have the option to do off-site in the same drainage basin. This would add a third option, which would be a fee in lieu mitigation, perhaps somewhere else in the city or in the watershed. There is an existing program in the Raya 8 watershed right now that the city staff has already investigated and believes we can participate in. So we do believe that this should be something to advance to our July conversation. It would also provide for consistency between the regulations for streams and wetlands. Recommendation number 4 is revising our buffer width calculations to evaluate the proposed land use intensity and buffer function. And this is a little bit of a complicated item, so I've devoted two slides to it just to make sure that it's clear as to what we are doing here. What we would do in evaluating a development proposal is evaluate, A, the quality of the buffer. So going back to our wetland example, we might be looking at wetland that has a buffer that's made of pasturage, or we might have a buffer that's comprised of forested condition. Those provide varying levels of functional value to the wetland itself. Fewer trees often means less habitat score, less in the way of water quality benefit. And we would also be evaluating the land use intensity of the development proposed adjacent to the wetland. That would allow the city to look at whether or not the wetland buffer was sized correctly for the development at hand. Meaning if we were looking at a highly intense project and a low quality buffer, we might actually need to expand the buffer. If we were looking, and I've given two other examples here on the screen, if we're looking at a high value buffer but also with a high intensity project, it may result in the buffer expanding somewhat. Similarly, high value buffer but a low intensity development, so maybe instead of an R4 subdivision, we're looking at an R1 subdivision, we might look at an actual reduction in the buffer necessary to protect the wetland feature. City staff is recommending that you advance that to your July hearing as another flexibility tool. Recommendation number 5 from the Best Available Science Report is to provide additional guidance for mitigating buffer impacts specifically related to wetlands. We would be looking at adopting mitigation ratios and revising them again to be specific to the functions and values of the wetland buffer in question. So we would be specifying wetland type, mitigation type, whether or not the impacts might be temporary, as in construction impacts related to the road installation or something of that nature, or more permanent where you might actually have the house and yard right next to the wetland. And we are recommending that you also advance this particular recommendation from the consultant. Recommendation number 6 is actually, so the previous recommendation was related to wetland buffers. This one is related directly to wetland mitigation ratios. So this is impacts to wetlands and the mitigation that we require for that. And this is going to establish those ratios based upon the type of mitigation proposed. You may recall in our Best Available Science presentation, the consultant had a very detailed matrix, which I have not tried to capture here tonight, which focused on if you're purely talking about wetland enhancement as your mitigation approach, you may have a much higher ratio than if you're actually talking about wetland creation and buffer enhancement, for example. It would increase predictability on the part of the applicant. It's also a more complex mitigation system. It's not the one size fits all. And so I do want to caution the Planning Commission that it's something I think we need to evaluate more carefully in July as we actually have draft code for you to look at. But we are recommending that you advance it for our July hearing. Recommendation number 7. This would provide additional guidance concerning the small isolated wetlands. This is not the wetland exemption item that we're going to be talking about in a minute. Many of the commissioners may know we're talking about increasing the exemption level from 1,000 to 4,000. This is not that recommendation. This is actually evaluating when we're talking about a small isolated wetland, what is that wetland's function and value to the watershed before we approve any alteration to it. Some are hydrologically exempt, provide respectfully relatively little function or value to the watershed. Many are not going to fall into that category. This would allow the city staff to evaluate on a case-by-case basis the actual value of the wetland in question. This is again an item that we would look at advancing to our July hearing. Recommendation number 8 is another one of those recommendations that essentially identifies a past choice on the part of the City Council balancing two policy goals. In this particular case, the consultant has noted that there's not really a best available science justification for exempting the recently adopted town center regulations from some of the wetland management area requirements related to impervious surface and vegetation standards. City staff is, as you might guess, recommending that we not advance this particular recommendation onto our July hearing. The basic reason for that is that the consultant doesn't provide any new additional best available science information that would provide a compelling case to change the past City Council's decision related to the town center. So to remind the Planning Commission, a year or three ago now, the City Council evaluated the town center, determined that they wanted that area to be an area of relatively high intensity, high development capacity, mixed-use development, commercial residential. As part of that, they decided also to exempt the town center from certain provisions of the wetland management area that would counteract a high-density development. There's no new information in the consultant's report that would prompt the City Council or frankly, the Planning Commission to revisit that past decision. That's the basis for the city recommending that we not advance this recommendation on to July. Recommendation number nine would be to look at, specifically within the wetland management areas. The Planning Commission may recall that the wetland management areas are focused on the high-value wetlands that we have in the city of Sammamish, primarily the bog systems, some of the other high category one wetland systems. The recommendation from the consultant is that we look at improving wildlife habitat connectivity within those wildlife management areas because they contain high-value wetland functions, habitat functions. This is something that could have fallen out of either the Fish and Wildlife Habitat Conservation Area Best Available Science Report or the Wetland Management Area Report. The consultant elected to put it in here. City staff is recommending that you look at this option, but we would include it as part of our Fish and Wildlife Habitat Conservation Area regulations for conversation in July. It would essentially be an enhancement to our wildlife corridors provisions. Recommendation number 10 is related to buffer reduction options in combination with preserving, maintaining wildlife habitat functions. For example, we would allow buffer reductions more readily if we're talking about an undisturbed vegetated corridor. We're keeping buffer conditions, existing buffer conditions are not degraded, so less than 40% of the buffer area is covered by invasive non-native plants. Vegetation covers less than 25% of the buffer area, et cetera. These would provide, again, some additional flexibility on the part of the city staff in determining what the appropriate buffer would be off a wetland feature. And we are recommending that you advance this item further into the process so we can provide you with a good analysis of whether or not it would fit in Sammamish. Recommendation number 11 is specifically not a regulatory amendment to the Critical Areas Code. So this would fall into the category, frankly, of one of the items brought up by Mr. Brockway earlier tonight, of a recommendation to the City Council as a follow-up item to your eventual amendment to the Critical Areas Regulations. This specific recommendation is to conduct one or more focused basin-level planning studies to evaluate the existing functions of wetland features and likely future development patterns. That evaluation will be used to inform later Planning Commission or City Council decisions on how to handle development growth as we move forward. So this is an information gathering recommendation on the part of the consultant. Staff does recommend that this is a useful thing for us to do, especially as we move forward with our comprehensive plan update in 2013-2014, and as we may need to look at critical area updates in the long term. Over time, so we do recommend that you pursue this amendment or include it as part of your overall recommendation to the City Council, pardon me. Next set of recommendations from 12 on through the rest of the consultant recommendations here are related to the Lake Management District. I haven't made that quite as clear as I could have in the slides. But in the Lake Management area, the consultant is recommending adding additional thresholds to trigger stormwater treatment for redeveloping sites and pervious pollutant generating sites. Pervious pollutant generating sites, if you're not familiar, may be things like lawns. We might be talking about putting down pollution generating lawns, for lack of a better word, would be something that we may want to regulate as part of our lake management area regulations. It would add additional specific thresholds for redeveloping property, not just new development, which is where our current standard sits, especially in applying the 80% phosphorus removal. City staff does think that this particular recommendation is worth advancing to the July public hearing. I do think it requires a little bit further analysis as to whether or not it's frankly practicable in the Lake Management District, and that would be part of our advancement. Recommendation number 13. the way the lake management area standards are currently configured, 80% of phosphorus removal is mandated for new development. There are a number of technologies that are specifically identified in our regulations on how you could achieve that phosphorus removal standard. The recommendation from the consultant is to specify one additional methodology standard, which would be using Ecology's tape protocol as a method for removing phosphorus in a stormwater treatment system. City does currently accept alternative technologies. This is one we already accept. This would provide clarification as to a proposed approach on the part of a developer, but it's not necessarily a new regulation per se, in that it's a change on the part of city staff review. Clarification is useful, though. It does provide predictability for property owners, so we are recommending to advance this to our July hearing. Speaking more slowly is drying out my throat. I apologize. Recommendation number 14. Again, this is a recommendation on how we calculate that phosphorus removal within the lake management districts, lake management areas. In particular, the consultant has recommended that we give a specific guiding procedure to a potential developer on how you would evaluate phosphorus removal. This would require a site-by-site evaluation to evaluate whether or not the 80% phosphorus removal will be achieved in every case. City staff is recommending that you advance this in a modified form. The goal on the part of the consultant, frankly, is to ensure that we are meeting best available science by always ensuring that we get 80% phosphorus removal. The challenge with an engineering design computation generated for every site is that it may not be appropriate if we're talking about a small site development. We might be looking at a small single family home, for example, that just barely triggers the threshold. In that particular case, there's probably a better appropriate ways for city staff to guide the prospective property owner in how to develop the site without triggering the specific site-by-site engineering review. So we are recommending to advance this in a modified form. Recommendation number 15 talks about source control best management practices. I apologize, alphabet soup on the screen here. BMPs stands for best management practices. This would provide additional controls on sources of water quality issues in Beaver and Pine Lake. The two main ones, frankly, are fecal coliform and phosphorus transferal into the lakes. Fecal matter in general, we believe primarily comes from pet waste around the lakes, in particular in Beaver Lake. We have a fair bit of information around that. And the use of fertilizers, phosphorus-bearing fertilizers on landscaping. There are existing regulations in effect right now governing both of these topics. They are not regulated as part of our critical areas ordinance. So the proposal at hand really is to take those regulations that are elsewhere in the city's ordinance set and apply them to our critical area regulations. It would provide clarity. It likely would come up as part of a development proposal only if we're added to our critical area regulations. And so one of the things city staff is recommending, if you decide to advance this, is to evaluate whether or not there's actually a practical change in how widely these restrictions are disseminated to the public. Recommendation number 16 is actually a recommendation to the Beaver Lake Management District, taxing district, as you may know, that correlates to the Beaver Lake Management area. The Beaver Lake Management District conducts phosphorus modeling work. They're actually in the process of updating their phosphorus model now. And the consultant is recommending that they evaluate the impacts of stormwater treatment performance goals in reducing phosphorus loading to the lake. So this is a recommendation to the Beaver Lake Management District, essentially to include another aspect of phosphorus sourcing in their model when they update the model again. And what they're specifically asking the Beaver Lake Management to do is compare the 80% target in phosphorus reduction to the new redevelopment target established by King County and Ecology of 50%, and kind of compare what those two features are. Again, with item number 16, this is not a specific code amendment. This is a recommendation, frankly, to another body here at the city, the Beaver Lake Management District, but it is one that the city staff would recommend you forward on for council review. And now we're moving into our public comments, and this is comment number 17, or recommendation number 17, pardon me. It does come out of public comment number 5 and number 73. These are very similar recommendations, number 17 and number 18, to the recommendations you saw for the stream buffers at our last meeting. In particular, what this would allow the city to do is evaluate specific site conditions in establishing a wetland buffer. So we would be evaluating where the house might be, if there was existing landscaping, other barriers to a wetland buffer that would otherwise provide some kind of functional protection to the wetland itself. We are recommending that we advance this item forward for a conversation in July. We do need to evaluate, and pardon me, I'm not sure if I included a slide. We are recommending that you advance both items, the other item being, and I flipped past it, pardon me, distinguishing between developed and undeveloped land when establishing wetland buffers. It's very analogous to the first item where we'd be evaluating, are you in a forested condition, in which case maybe a prescriptive wetland buffer should apply, versus an area that has a historic pattern of development around it since the 1970s and before, whether or not we should look at a more site-by-site evaluation. We are recommending that you advance both public comment recommendations to our July hearing. Similar to our conversation around the streams, we do need to evaluate a number of aspects of these recommendations, both with best available science, and then if there's not best available science, identifying an appropriate policy basis otherwise for this type of amendment for this for the Planning Commission to use. And we do have a couple of other items, frankly, that we need to think about further, investigate further as staff. Ease of use for city and applicants, consistency from site to site, ensuring an equity, and looking again at the policy basis for the amendment. Recommendation number 19, pardon me, was the item I referred to earlier related to isolated wetlands. The Planning Commission may note there's been a fair bit of public comment on this particular wetland exemption threshold. We currently have a threshold of 1,000 square feet and where you can apply for a wetland that's hydrologically isolated to be exempted from some of our critical area regulations. We've had recommendations from the public that go anywhere from 1,000 square feet up to 5,000 square feet. We did have a specific recommendation from the Department of Ecology that we could look at increasing our threshold from 1,000 square feet to 4,000 square feet. And that is the specific one that the city staff has proposed for your review tonight. That, of course, could be something that you would modify further as we move into July. And I am looking for specific direction there after public comment. Best available science report, I'll just remind the Planning Commission, did look at a number of peer jurisdictions, and of those jurisdictions found that the range was really between about 250 square feet on up to 2,500 square feet at the upper end. 4,000 square feet, I believe we've had testimony, though, is used by some jurisdictions not in that peer jurisdiction group, and I believe City of Black Diamond was included in that reference, and I don't know if there might be others. As a way of scale for the Planning Commission, 2,000 square feet might be a little bit of a hard number to envision for those of you who don't work with ground all the time. This room is about 2,000 square feet in area. So our current threshold for exempting a wetland is about half the size of this room. If we were to bump the exemption level up to 4,000 square feet, it would be about twice the size of this room, the council chambers. City staff is recommending that you advance the wetland exemption increase forward to our July conversation. Recommendation number 20 actually came from public comment number 75. I believe the gentleman testified that we had a number of wetland definitions contained within our code, which is true. He did note that we were using an older version of the definition, which was one of our early recommendations. He also recommended that we consolidate wetland definitions across the code. And to the extent that is feasible, we do intend to do so. And so we are recommending that the Planning Commission advance this item forward for further review. Which brings us to the very last recommendation coming from the public for the Planning Commission's consideration. And this is to evaluate an allowance for the use of wetlands as stormwater management facilities, at least in part. The code currently allows for some limited use of frankly, low-value small wetlands as stormwater management facilities, and has some options for example, allowing discharge from a stormwater pond into a wetland or a wetland buffer. The proposed amendment would evaluate increasing the types of wetlands to include low-function Category 3 and 4 wetlands if mitigation was also provided. Staff is recommending that you evaluate, advance this amendment to July, and then we have a fair bit of work to evaluate the proposed change as part of our preparation for your July conversation. We're recommending to advance it because it does provide additional tools during permit review, additional flexibility, which is one of our known topic goals from the City Council. I think it's fair to say that the city staff has some reservation about whether or not the proposed amendment would be supported by best available science, if it's consistent with other jurisdictions' regulations. Please recall that wetlands are regulated by Department of Ecology, at least, in some cases the Army Corps of Engineers. And we do want to make sure that we have a good way of tracking consistency between applications over time and keeping adequate records on how we're managing these facilities, facilities/wetlands, if we do allow this type of activity. And if it's not supported by best available science, then we do need to identify a good policy basis for this type of amendment. And with that, Chair, respectfully, unless there are questions for me, I'd suggest opening the public comment period.
Do we have any questions for staff at this time from the commission?
You're holding those.
We are holding them. I just thought I'd... Real quick. Okay, sounds good. So at this time, we'll open public comment for the, hopefully specific to the recommendations that we have just been presented. Is there a sign-up sheet, Evan? Thank you. We'll start with the sign-up sheet, and then if there's anyone else that would like to speak that hasn't signed up, we can add you to the end. So the first person that signed up has already been provided testimony is Mr. Krabby, and I believe he's not here anymore. So, okay. And the next person is Ms. Eastlick. Do you have further comment? Great. Next person is Mr. Brockway. No. Ms. Stahl.
Good evening. Eileen Stahl, 21553 Southeast 28th Lane, here in Sammamish. At the last Planning Commission meeting, I stated that a different, not a balanced approach is needed for our current ECA review. Balance is sometimes a good thing, but not when it endangers the greater public good. The reasons a balanced approach is not appropriate are pretty clear. Over time, growth degrades our sensitive areas and reduces their ability to function. However, as we grow, more and more pressure is put on those resources that are not growing but actually shrinking. If the environment and development rights were equal, our wetlands and lakes could grow along with urbanization. But all is not equal. Every day, our lakes and wetlands are encroached upon further. So what do we do? Instead of restoring them, we reevaluate them and reclassify them as less important and allow more encroachment. Yet we continue to rely on them just as much as ever to protect us from flooding and landslides, to infiltrate our groundwater and protect our quality of life with open space and habitat for wildlife. Under these circumstances, increased protections are called for, and not only because the science is telling us so. Our plateau environment is unique, and the forces of nature can have devastating results here, as landslides can cause loss of property and public safety. As a community, we need to put a priority on protecting the resources for the greater public good. In response specifically to the wetland overlay recommendation 3.2, having the critical area study extended 215 feet beyond the project boundary, we think it is important to note that wetland and stream systems are dynamic and change over time, meandering and changing to accommodate new circumstances and land use. In addition, the wetland overlays were only applied to Class 1 wetland systems. So even if there's a little stream in the overlays, they're still very important, even if they're not technically high-grade wetland or a high-grade stream. They're part of a higher-grade system. That's why they had the overlays. They were systems. The wetland overlays were created more than a decade ago. As a growing city, increases in stormwater flows from surrounding land use changes are common. Therefore, the PC should advance this recommendation to July. Wetland Overlay Recommendation 3.8 asks the city to provide justification for extending the town center area from impervious surface and vegetation standards in the wetland management area. In 2005, there was inadequate justification given by the city, which simply stated that it could not meet the density requirements of the town center without removing the overlays. To our knowledge, this is not true. Densities can be met by having building grow vertically rather than horizontally, which adds a lot more impervious surface. The LID principles that the council applied to the town center instead cannot substitute for the wetland overlay, which specifically addresses the complexities of these wetland and stream systems. Best available science was applied when the overlays were created. The overlays protect the headwaters of two important streams, George Davis Creek and Ebright Creek, in addition to Lake Sammamish. Adequate justification must be given for excluding these overlay limitations. In addition, there was no public process that accompanied this provision of the CAO. It was done at the last minute on the final day of deliberations and was brought before the council without public knowledge that it would be presented as an option. Therefore, the public was not allowed to research the subject, discuss the provision openly, or comment publicly. We recommend that this recommendation go forward to July, if only to have some public review and comment. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stahl. Next, we have Ms. Tiliakos.
Erica Tiliakos, 1130 Lancaster Way, Southeast in Sammamish. Planning commissioners and staff, the following comments are submitted by Friends of Pine Lake, a local nonprofit group that since 1998 has made continuous efforts to preserve the integrity of our natural environment on the Sammamish Plateau. These are further general comments on the proposed review you are now undertaking, specifically the proposed areas of wetland regulations. 3.3, again, we would like to reiterate that fee in lieu mitigation is not something the city should adopt. The Sammamish Plateau is a high-value resource area that should be maintained locally and not degraded. Moving mitigation out of the city doesn't help our resources. Lake Sammamish is a large water body of the Wyra 8 watershed, and our protections to wetlands and streams directly affect the lake. 3.4, and 3.8, Department of Ecology wanted us to adopt these kinds of measures back when we did the 2005 update, and the city responded that we had wetland overlays that limited impervious surfaces to 8% in their catchments. The town center, however, has been excluded from these protections, so the standard buffer widths are no longer appropriate. We agree that buffers should be widened for higher density development, especially as they impact Class 1 wetlands and those below slopes. Buffers less than 50 feet, however, have been found to not adequately protect wetlands. This is discussed in the Department of Ecology's publication 9210, Wetland Buffers, Use and Effectiveness. 311, this is the basin update that we have been calling for years now to have been done. The city has updated the Inglewood and Thompson basins, but there are still the Monahan, Panhandle, Laughing Jacobs, Pine Lake subbasins to update. These updates should inform any proposed changes in the future. 317 and 318, only permit applications trigger any review of buffers on a property, and it is only proper for residential lots that have impacted buffers negatively be required to improve them. The burden should not be solely on new development, to fix what had been negatively impacted over the years. 319, we are not in agreement with increasing wetland exemption thresholds. Although the Department of Ecology has some guidance for small cities, it is not appropriate in the city of Sammamish. The Department of Ecology's guidance is for the cities that have not yet inventoried and evaluated their natural resources and is a way to help them get the job of getting their critical areas ordinances completed in time. The city of Sammamish has an extensive basin plan that inventoried the critical areas and has been updating regulations to continue to protect those resources. This is what should be guiding our critical area updates. The further clarification from Department of Ecology on these isolated wetlands is that they would only be considered isolated if not part of a riparian area. Most of our wetlands are associated with riparian areas, wetland systems and lake systems, and would not be treated as isolated wetlands. Furthermore, we live atop a plateau that needs the flow attenuation that all wetlands provide. Allowing filling of these wetlands will reduce areas that help slow stormwater flows and changes storage for impervious surfaces, the double whammy, so to speak. 321, early in the years of stormwater management, they thought wetlands would be a good place to put stormwater. This, however, turned out to be a big problem. A large study conducted over 7 years led to our current management of stormwater and wetland protections. This should not be carried forward. That led to this book, Wetlands and Urbanization and Implications for the Future. The greatest threats to our natural environment is no longer planned housing development. Developers amass several lots and protecting critical areas through buffers and so on are now common practice for them. Single lot-by-lot development is now our greatest threat. Unfortunately, project-by-project review does not address cumulative impacts, but the city is required to consider these impacts in permitting and drafting ordinances. Our 2005 update was pretty good, even though buffers were considered a little low on the low side. So good, it seems, that DOE called out the City of Sammamish's code as a model ordinance for wetland buffers. Attached is a copy of the National Wetlands Newsletter in 2008, Volume 30, Number 2, Environmental from the Law Environmental Institute in Washington, D.C. Wetlands provide important functions, more than just water quality. They are important nurseries in the spring for mammals and amphibians and provide flow attenuation during winter storms, protecting us all. I am attaching photos of amphibians. Thank you.
Any questions for Ms. Tiliakos?
I didn't get that book title, if she could repeat it.
Wetlands and Urbanization, Implications for the Future.
Thank you.
We have it online.
Great, thank you, Ms. Tiliakos. Next, Larry Martin was next. He appears to have spoken and have departed. And then I have Mr. Sorensen, who has chosen not to comment. Do I have anyone else that would like to comment? Ms. Gee, and then Mr. Blau, do I have that correct? You can follow Ms. Gee.
Megan Gee, 22201 Northeast 28th Place. I'd just like to say, reiterate what my husband said at the joint meeting. I think the process has been very good. We've been very pleased with the communication, both with the staff and Planning Commission, how it's been presented. I just think you're doing a good job and want to note that. As far as the isolated wetlands, we've been talking about the isolated wetlands increasing the exemptions to 4,000 square feet only on the low function, low value wetlands. As you get into this and, the code language is developed as far as what the mitigation is going to be, I know that the problem with the old code was we couldn't get beyond anything because if you could avoid the impact, then you didn't get down the list to other mitigation. I don't know what is going to come out of this, if this exemption passes or not. We don't need it to be totally exempted. I mean, I understand the need for mitigation. We don't have a problem with that. We just want to be able to get to the mitigation and you know, jump over that need to avoid. What I wanted to suggest is that a couple of options for mitigation, again, on these low function, low value wetlands below 4,000 square feet where there's no best available science that supports that they're good for water quality, if they have low score for animal habitat, you know, I'm sure people still want them, but you couldn't base it on best available science. I would recommend that the mitigation be for the hydrological value of these wetlands, which there's little evidence for that, since it's unreliable and lacks the basis of scientific evidence, that any stormwater, a proposed stormwater system, can replace any of the hydrological values. I know that the stormwater has just been updated, the stormwater manual, and that could replace the hydrological function. And second, that with the low scoring, if it has a score of an animal habitat score of under 20, that's considered fairly low, that be mitigated through the fee in lieu program. This would assure greater environmental benefit with the enhancement of an animal habitat to an already established wetland program. And so I believe that if a landowner is able to utilize both of these options, meaning a proposed stormwater system for the water quality and a fee in lieu program for the animal habitat, then that gives predictability, flexibility, it's clear and easy to apply, and it maintains the no net loss standard. So that would be my recommendation for mitigation to these small isolated wetlands. Thanks.
Thanks, Ms. Gee. Do we have any questions from the commission? No. All right, Mr. Blau.
Frank Blau, 24742 Southeast 28th Place, Sammamish. So it was interesting listening to these people talk because I was struck by something I heard someone say once, that just because some people say that the earth is flat and some people say that the earth is round, it doesn't mean that the answer is halfway in between. And I think a lot of these issues around wetlands, having recently taken a tour with city staff of some of the wetland areas, once they're gone, they're gone. Once you destroy the ecosystem that supports the wetland, you've destroyed it forever. You're not going to get it back in 20 years when you decide all of a sudden you want it back again. So I would, when I hear these recommendations to increase buffers to 4,000 when we already have a model recommendation that's gotten commendations from other organizations for what we have now, I'm hesitant to agree that we should actually increase it. As well as the exclusion of the city town center, I know that is far more complex than just a yes or no. There are a lot of issues that go into that, but I think that if you are going to exclude an area such as that, you should consider that very carefully, because again, that's an area where what we do there has downstream impacts all the way to Lake Sammamish and all the way to the Sound. And I would hate to be seen in 20 years from now that the source of pollution problems and the source of species die-off downstream from our plateau is the fingers pointed at us for those decisions. And so I also want to comment that there was an article in the paper today, or this week, a comment about the proceedings and sort of how they're going and comments that are being made, and how it seemed that there wasn't a large environmentalist presence. And so I'm here to say that there is. And we are proud to be a part of this process and appreciative that this work is being done. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blau. Do we have any questions? No. All right. We're glad you're here to represent. Do we have anyone else that would like to give comment on today's subjects for consideration? Mr. Gee.
I don't really want to get into a debate about whether the world is round or flat, but I do want to make a point that I think is important as we're talking about these issues. The labels of environmentalist or non-environmentalist and some of those things, I don't think are all that helpful. I quite frankly enjoy much of what we're all here to, you know, talk about, and preserving the things that actually have value and function is something I'm committed to as well and have been. Where we are here to sort of applaud the notion of looking more closely at some of these things in terms of what they actually do. Just because something could be designated as having some of the characteristics of a wetland, even the DOE folks and their publications recognize that there are limitations on their ability to gauge that. And so when we talk about balance, and balance is required as a matter of law by the Growth Management Act, I mean, we are an urban area. That's not something that we can change. We are here because we're an urban area. We're having this conversation. And in that conversation, the question should be, I think, what are the tools that help us best to balance these issues? The obviously, there's a desire to promote the green and the wonderful things that we see around us. And I don't think anybody here would debate that. And I frankly don't think it's helpful to point fingers and say that you know, I don't care about that just because I'm interested also in seeing value retained in my land. I would say that our push has been, and I've heard this from the commission, and I commend this. Let's look at if we're going to move one direction or the other. Let's base it on not just broad generalizations, but looking at actually does this do what we say it's going to do. If you're looking at wetlands, does it enhance the water quality? Is there something that it contributes to the area surrounding? And those things should be evaluated in a way that allows the staff, allows the administration of the ordinances to be done with that in mind, so that they're not constrained to, you know, a one-size-fits-all, paint-by-numbers kind of approach. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Gee. Any questions for Mr. Gee? Does anyone else, would anyone else care to provide public comment? Okay, I'm going to close public, I'm not speaking very loudly, am I? Must be tired. I'm going to close public comment for the evening. And I'm going to recommend actually that we take about a 5-minute break before we go through our recommendations. It seems like a good brief stopping point. So let's reconvene at 7:25. Thank you.
6 minutes. Well, I figured it would be easier than 7:24.
I'd like to request the commissioners take their seats. Thank you. You want to remind us what we're doing, Evan?
Thank you, Chair. So now is the opportunity for the Planning Commission to go through, certainly ask any questions of me. From our initial presentation and the recommendations.
What did you do to Debbie?
Shorter, that's 2-3 strikes and you're out.
Is this going on my performance report? Oh,
Debbie wants to go home.
It's how the English do things. Get it done. Pardon me. So we can go through the recommendations, of course, before the Planning Commission tonight. If I failed to explain something clearly moments ago, please embarrass me and point that out so I can seek to do better this time. And certainly if there's additional information or analysis that the Planning Commission needs in making a recommendation to advance or not, please let me know that as well. And with that, Chair, respectfully, I've itemized out the amendments in just 4 short slides and tried to make it clear in the itemization. I can go back earlier into the PowerPoint if need be, but I thought we'd start here and see how it goes from there.
Actually, can you put up more than one recommendation at a time? There we go. Thank you.
I can do 5.
Yes, yes.
You can do 5. You can't do 6. I'll have to ask for that. Oh! Very good.
Sorry.
Okay, so we do have 21 recommendations to go through. So what I'd like to do is focus our time on areas where we have questions for clarification. I'll kind of do what we've done in the past, kind of start on one side or the other. But I would suggest if you don't have questions, you just say whether or not you are comfortable with the recommendation that we have in front of us, whether to advance or not, whatever the staff recommendation is. So we'll start with 3-1. This is to adopt the latest federal delineation manual. We'll start on my left with Commissioner Collins. Do you have any questions?
My question is whether or not we go by FEMA or Army Corps of Engineers. The source documents are Army Corps of Engineers. In the frequently FFA, you had FEMA as it. So I'd kind of like, if we vote to advance this, I'd like to see a little bit of thing about FEMA versus Army Corps of Engineers.
Are you suggesting that we consider advancing it? Is that your position
yes.
on this? Thank you. Commissioner Coleman.
Advance.
Go ahead, Wasserman.
Advance.
Commissioner Luxemburg.
Pass.
Okay. Pass as in no comment?
Correct.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Mabubu Islam. Gosh, why do I do that with you?
That's okay. We are friends.
Thank you.
Advance with the comment that local governments are always in the catching up game when federal and state changes things. So advance. Okay.
Commissioner Lipinski.
Advance.
Wonderful. So we're going to advance number one. Number two, I'll start on my right with Commissioner Lipinski. This is to modify the critical area study requirement. Staff recommends that we not advance this. We did have some public comment on this particular item. Would like to know, Commissioner Lipinski, if you have any questions and whether or not you would like to proceed with the staff recommendation or not.
No questions, and I would agree with the staff.
Great.
I oppose the staff recommendation. Maybe I've spoken before you have looked at me. Sorry about that.
No, you're fine.
Primarily because consultants have given very clear direction, 215 feet. That does not require any interpretation. And in the staff comment, there are arbitrary wording like distance may lead to unnecessary expenditure in studies. It could be on the other side too. If we don't go far enough in some areas, then we are losing the necessity there too. I would also comment that 215 feet is sort of a middle ground of what ecology range was. It was between, I think, about 150 to 300 feet. So I would like to see precise wording. In some ways, I see that staff recommendation, the distance equal to the largest potential required buffer, mm-hmm. that's actually may mean that 215 feet or change depending on the class or categories.
Do you want clarification?
Yeah, if I may, Chair. The language it captured in the memo is actually the current language. So you're entirely correct, Commissioner Islam. We do sometimes require that an applicant go out 215 feet.
So again, my answer was I agree with the consultant's recommendation, not with the staff recommendation.
Thank you, Commissioner Islam. Commissioner, my goodness, Luxemburg.
Thank you. I would agree with the staff recommendation in this case.
Commissioner Wasserman?
I would agree to not advance it.
Commissioner Coleman?
I'll admit I'm a little bit on the fence about this. I agree with staff's review that they've already got the tool in the toolbox to do this. But on the other hand, I'm a proponent of having a code that gives property owners a level of predictability. And when things are left to discretion, you know, it could seem to different property owners that maybe one property owner got a different level of discretion than another one did. And so I'm kind of on the side of saying, let's require that a property owner go out a certain distance. And if they can't get that access from the adjacent property owner, then it basically falls back to the information that's already on hand. So I think I'm going to agree with Commissioner Islam, but on a slightly different reason. I think we need to provide predictability in our code, and so I would like to see the consultant's recommendation in advance.
Commissioner Collins.
I agree that staff has to make the interpretation on these. They're going to do it through administrative rules if they don't have it in code. I'd just as soon allow them to do it the way they wish to do it.
So what I'd like to do is I'd like to request that staff prepare us with some alternatives to consider, the current code being one of them, a prescriptive rule being a second, and perhaps we can talk about what a third might look like. But I think that's really the question that we're talking about here, is whether or not we have a specific rule about the number of feet that a development would look at versus what's in the code today, which includes some discretion. Yes, Commissioner Lipinski.
I'm confused. I thought we were seen as a body if we wanted to advance this, and it looked like it was 5-2 or 4-3 not to advance
it. So we're not taking this as a vote, and I think that we have had enough conversation about this to continue the discussion.
Okay.
Rather than close it off at this point, I also want to be mindful of the public comment that we've received on this item. All right, number three. So this is the fee in lieu mitigation program for wetland impacts. I'll remind the commission that we did recommend proceeding this alternative for streams. So with that, I'd like to start with Commissioner Lipinski. The staff is recommending that we advance this option.
I agree.
I will go with the staff recommendation with the comment that when we discussed with King County about the fee in lieu program, we wanted to make sure that we give preference to our city critical areas where we can have a receiving critical area within the city limits.
Commissioner Luxembourg.
I would agree with the comment that Commissioner Islam just made.
Commissioner Wasserman.
I would vote that we advance it.
Commissioner Coleman.
I agree.
Collins.
I agree with Commissioner Islam.
Okay, great. So we're all going to advance with preference to be provided to us in our proposed recommendation. Number four.
Now I have a question.
Yes.
What's the preference in Sammamish?
So the request is when we do a fee in lieu program that we provide some sort of incentive or prioritization that the in lieu, that whatever that fee is used for, be used for something that benefits the city or our watershed. Am I understanding that correctly, Commissioner Islam? Okay.
Now is our watershed Lake Sammamish, right? So it can improve it in Bellevue.
But not explicitly. Are you asking? Yes?
Mike is shaking his head, so I'm fine.
Pardon me, Chair. Just to correct the record, the watershed is actually much larger than Lake Sammamish. The RIA encompasses much of Western Washington. Let me think.
And that's partly why I wanted to say the watershed. So you're comfortable with that scope, is that correct, Commissioner?
Okay. Is a couple of hundred miles to a couple of thousand miles.
Right. So it's not limited to the city of Sammamish.
Correct. Thank you, Commissioner Lipinski, for the clarification. Did you have another comment, Commissioner?
But Collins? Preferred.
Am I going too fast?
Now I'm confused again. We're just moving this forward for discussion.
Correct.
Okay, fine.
Yes, and we can decide what limitations we might want to put on this, but I do think there's definitely a desire to provide some sort of guidance around the scope of where that fee in lieu could be used.
Chair, if I may, I'll just recap what I understand the Planning Commission's direction to be, which is that we are going to provide a fee in lieu mitigation option. It will be bifurcated, with the first preference being a fee in lieu within the city limits, and the second option being a fee in lieu within the watershed RIA.
And that's where I disagree. So I want to see both.
So I think Commissioner Lipinski is requesting that we have a bifurcated option to consider and one that's not bifurcated, that doesn't explicitly state a preference. Is that correct?
Yes.
Great. Thank you.
Mike, I don't see the difference of fixing the creek in Sammamish or fixing the creek in Enumclaw if they both go into the same watershed.
But the reason why is because the money comes from Sammamish is the reason for a preference. Okay. We want to see fixes here first, if we can.
I want to make a comment. I do want to have an opportunity for the commission to have these more detailed discussions similar to what we are having now. For each recommendation as we get into some of the specifics. So, for example, if staff had presented us with the original alternative, and Commissioner Lipinski, you want to also consider an alternative that doesn't show a bifurcated option, we will have that discussion in a much more detailed manner. I think what we want to do is provide staff with direction, as we have tonight, about what kinds of options we might want to see to further the conversation. So thank you for creating an example for us. Okay, so that was 3-3. We're on number four. And this is to revise the buffer width requirements to include, I actually would like you to state this for us differently because the statement in our memo and on the other slide is a little bit more specific.
Pardon me while I scroll back up to
that
slide.
It's all right.
I apologize for the blinking lights.
So while you do that, I'll just read it. Revised buffer width requirements to include evaluations of the land use intensity and the existing buffer function and condition. Okay.
And so what you have on the screen before you tonight and what staff will prepare for you in more detail if you decide to advance this amendment is a couple of examples of how this would work on the ground. So if you had a, if I may, Chair, I'll just provide a
Please.
Quick example. If you had a subdivision that we were looking at, and the subdivision might occur on a site where you have a wetland area kind of in the middle of the property, similar to our stream example last time, on one side you might have pasturage, on the other side you might have trees, forested condition. In the case of the wetland buffer on the pasturage side, and frankly, to some extent, in pardon me if I did not explain this very well, say that property is being subdivided to an R4 density, so a standard subdivision within the city of Sammamish, similar to pretty much all the subdivisions we live in. That's a relatively low-intensity development project. For the area that is relatively low-quality buffer, we may be looking at a bigger buffer area to provide the same type of protection for a low-intensity project compared to a high-quality buffer, the forested condition, where we may need less width because it's a higher quality feature. So this is going to adjust your buffer widths overall based on the development that's proposed and the type of buffer we're talking about. It's going to provide more flexibility in terms of actually protecting the feature and looking at what's on the ground, looking at the functions and values of that wetland buffer. But it is also going to reduce your predictability a little bit. So this is one of those choices you're going to have to make. I'm going to use a counterexample, if I may, real quickly, just to illustrate this one other way. Same property that we were just talking about before, but we're looking at a condo project, R12 density, something that's fairly intense development. So it's a high-intensity project. Even with the high-value buffer, because it's high-intensity, you're probably going to have a bigger buffer than you would if it was an R4-zoned property. Does that make sense?
Any further clarification questions for staff? Okay. We'll start with Commissioner Collins on
support.
This. You support advancing this?
Yes.
Thank you. Commissioner Coleman?
I support advancing it.
Commissioner Wasserman?
Support advancing it.
Commissioner Luxembourg? I'm going to mess you guys up. I'm going to say somebody else's name one of these days.
I agree with supporting this, and I appreciate the explanation. Thank you.
Yes. Commissioner Islam?
I'm intrigued with the idea, but I agree that it increases uncertainty. It increases the number of magic numbers that I've heard from some commenters, especially when we would be, or city would be interpreting what's low intensity, what's high intensity. There's no universal definition for any of those. I personally like the King County approach where they just went with two approaches, one for UTA, urban growth boundary areas, assuming all areas are equally developed, and one for rural areas. So I'm intrigued with that idea. I would be okay with advancing, but I would defer it for further discussions until I see city's proposal and how they are coming up with definitions for low intensity and high intensity.
Thank you. Commissioner Lipinski.
I agree.
Great. So we are recommending that we advance this. I do have one additional request for staff. I'd like to understand how improvements or enhancements to the buffer might also be taken into consideration in this type of scenario.
I do have a question.
Oh, Commissioner Wasserman.
This is a roundabout question, Evan, but between some of the comments where we start looking at a man-made structure as the edge of a boundary, how does something like that start tying into high-density buffers and wide buffers and things of high value? I think somewhere there needs to be a tie to some of these things.
Yeah, and I think this will be an easier conversation, frankly, when you have draft code in front of you. So let me preface my comments by that.
Okay.
Because at some level, the city staff is going to have to generate some code documents for you to look at as a starting point for your conversation. So the way I would envision doing that, at least for the starting point, is maybe starting to think about, if we're talking about site-specific buffer delineation, I don't know quite what to call this approach, but one of the things that we identified for the streams and possibly for tonight for wetlands would be site-specific buffer evaluations. That probably makes the most sense, at least as I understand it, when we're talking about a project in an existing neighborhood, maybe in the context of a single-family home renovation, something where you have by definition, a wetland buffer or a stream buffer that is going to not be in your kind of pristine forested condition. For something like this that we're looking at tonight, recommendation number four, you know, this really lends itself more to looking at the raw piece of ground that's relatively undeveloped, mm-hmm. might have been used for farm pasturage or something in the past, but it's not really in a neighborhood. You know, we're not talking about something in Waverly Park, we're talking about, you know, up in high country or something of that nature. And in that case, this is geared more towards what I tend to traditionally think of as development. You're okay. looking at a subdivision or a conditional use permit. And I would suggest that's probably the right way for at least to start by drafting the code. So you have that kind of distinction between types of development, single family modifications, or new development in the sense of new subdivisions. I could be getting that wrong, and I'm sure we'll hear from it from the public if I am. But that would be a good way to at least set that initial threshold, and then the Planning Commission could modify it from there.
Does that clarify?
Mm-hmm.
Great. Any other questions for staff on this item? Okay. Let's go to 3-5. This is a recommendation that we provide additional guidance for mitigation impacts to wetland buffers. For example, specific mitigation ratios. Staff is recommending that we advance this. I'll start with Commissioner Lipinski.
I agree.
Commissioner Islam?
I have a clarifying question. Number 5 and number 6 both are talking about mitigation ratios. I believe number 5 is about buffers and number 6 about mitigation ratio.
Yes, sir.
I will go ahead and advance 3-5, although I would like to see an example of how it works when you provide us more information.
Okay. Commissioner Luxembourg?
I would agree to advance.
Commissioner Wasserman?
I would agree to advance.
Commissioner Coleman?
I agree.
Commissioner Collins?
Advance.
I agree. I have no further comment. We can go to 3-6. We'll start with Commissioner Collins. This is to revise the mitigation ratios in the code to be dependent. No, did I just skip that? No.
No, you're there.
Thank you. I'm there. To be dependent on the kind of mitigation proposed.
I'd like to see some kind of comment with a combo of being able to do banking and fee in lieu in conjunction with it. The on-site mitigation is important, and I just don't want to assume that that's going to go away. I'd like to see being able to do a combo.
So if we add mitigation alternatives,
yes.
You want those to be included in this particular recommendation?
Right.
Okay, great, thank you. Commissioner Coleman?
I agree with that.
Commissioner Wasserman?
I would say advance.
Commissioner Luxembourg?
Advance.
Commissioner Islam?
Also advance with the thought that I would like to see an example like table for City of Redmond Head for our city.
Great. And Commissioner Lipinski?
Advance.
Wonderful, we're advancing 3-6. 3-7, provide additional guidance, both allowances and limitations concerning small, isolated wetlands. We'll start with Commissioner Lipinski. Staff has recommended that we advance this.
I agree.
Commissioner Islam.
Again, I have a question, Evan. I didn't see this as part of consultant's recommendation, but perhaps you might want to direct me to where it is coming from.
Oh, you want the reference in there?
Reference for consultant's recommendation for this.
Yeah, I can provide that, Commissioner Islam. If I may, I may provide it after our meeting tonight. The consultant's best available science reports included a number of very specific recommendations kind of at the end. And then one of the things I observed when we observed the best available science presentation is actually they identified a number of recommendations that were kind of in the body of the text that weren't called out explicitly. This is one of those. And in the effort for staff not to kind of filter out these recommendations inappropriately, we've gone through the report and specifically identified every recommendation that's in there, even if it's not called out by the consultant. And I can give you that
maybe
citation.
Maybe offline or after the meeting, I'll get the reference. But for now, I will advance, but I would like to see a definition of small, what small means.
Great. Commissioner Luxembourg.
I agree to advance.
Commissioner Wasserman.
I would agree to advance.
Commissioner Coleman.
I agree.
Commissioner Collins.
Advance.
Great. We are advancing this with some additional information as requested by Commissioner Islam. Okay. So the next one is 3-8. And this is relative to town center. I think this is one of our rather controversial recommendations, perhaps to some degree, where the city has made a policy choice. The best available science report has recommended that we reopen this policy choice for further discussion. And staff has recommended, and I'm going to read this just from the memo, that has stated that the best available science report prepared by the consultant does not contain any information that would prompt a reevaluation of the policy choice recently made by the City Council. Now, this does not preclude us from proceeding with reopening this for conversation, but we do have some council direction already from their previous action relative to this item. So,
what was there?
So the council is in their town center regulation had already made a decision about this particular item. We've heard from the public that perhaps there was not sufficient public comment during that period of time, and from the consultant that perhaps this decision is not supported by best available science even at the time. So it was a policy decision at the time. So with that,
I have a question.
Yes, Commissioner Lipinski.
When did the City Council adopt this?
When?
Yes.
Well, the wetland management area regulations were modified in 2005 as part of the critical areas adoption at that time. They were in the process of putting together, as I recall, the town center study area and the initial town center planning documents. And then it was also evaluated as part of the actual town center plan adoption. We did an environmental impact statement at that time. We did a number of other reviews that I probably can't quote chapter and verse at this moment. We did a supplemental EIS as well.
And it looks like in the information provided in the memo that the regulations were adopted in late 2010. I'm not sure if this was where in that process of adoption this particular item was discussed.
So this particular item, really the change was made initially in 2005 and then reaffirmed through the 2010 adoption.
Thank you for clarifying that. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Great. Do we have any other questions before we have a brief discussion on this? Okay. Why don't I go ahead and start with Commissioner Lipinski?
Well, based on that the council looked at this recently and made a policy decision, I agree with staff recommendation.
Okay. Commissioner Islam.
I disagree with the staff recommendation. This is probably one prime example when policy decisions are being made, they also need to be explained. This recommendation, as I understand from the consultant, is not asking for giving best available science behind it. It is asking for just an explanation of the justification. So I think that's something we owe to the public. That's something we owe to everybody. Also, when we waive critical area improvement in one area, that means we are really shifting the burden to other areas from a cumulative impact standpoint. And I want ourselves to be reminded, anytime we are exempting, we need to go back and look at where we are going to get that net gain so that we can exempt in some other areas. So I think for both reasons, I think at least we need to go back and get a justification for it. I'm not privy to overturn the decision council has made, but I think we owe a justification.
Commissioner Luxembourg.
I'm troubled by this. I'm mindful of the public comment, and I'm also mindful of the comments that Commissioner Islam has just made. And I'm also mindful of the fact that essentially we're being told that there's no new information since the council made their decision. And based on that, I find it difficult to reopen this when they considered it and they did it several times over several years. So I'm going to go with the recommendation of the staff.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Wasserman.
I think I'm looking at it from a different point of view. I agree with what Commissioner Luxembourg said about a best available science, but I'm finding it troubling the fact that Sammamish is getting awards for being green and being environmentally conscious. The biggest development that we're going to do is going to say no to that. You know, it's basically going to turn its back on that. I don't know if advancing this would or would not change anybody's opinion. I think what it's doing is wrong, personally, but I don't think I can advance it. There's nothing to show me anything. I would like to see some more information. I'd like to see the City Council explain why they made the decision that they did.
Okay. Commissioner Coleman.
I agree with staff's recommendation to not advance.
Commissioner Collins.
I'm torn on this. I agree with the staff as far as not advancing it, but I'd still like to include something in the handoff package asking the City Council to again say that this is a policy decision and reaffirm it.
So I'm wanting to maybe try to narrow in on what we're asking staff. I can tell that we're all having, not maybe not all of us, but there, this is, as I anticipated, a somewhat difficult topic for us. And so I do think that there is at least through a few of us a request for what was the policy reason for making this change that was adopted by the council. And I think that we as a commission would like to understand that better. We may or may not reopen this item in the sense of changing it, but I think we would like, as part of our Q&A, some further clarification, and perhaps we could put this in the follow-up list for consideration by the council at a minimum. Would that satisfy everyone? Mm-hmm. Is that sufficient?
Sounds good.
I'm seeing lots of head nods. Evan? We've started to collect a list of follow-up items. What I'd like to do is add this to the list of follow-up items that we go back to council and say, hey, we had some public comment on this. It may or may not have been in scope. What I'm hearing is really from the best available science. There's no new science, so it wouldn't necessarily have been triggered there either. But we're wanting the council to be aware of this. And I think we owe ourselves and the public a better understanding of the policy justification for this decision in the first place. And if we don't have a policy justification that we're comfortable with, perhaps the commission could then have a further discussion on this item, as part of our deliberation.
Chair, if I may, I just want to make sure I heard two directions there, and I want to make sure I capture both correctly. One is to make sure it makes it up onto your follow-up
at a minimum
recommendation.
Yes.
And second is to provide a report back to the Planning Commission as to the original policy basis.
Correct. Commissioner Collins, did you have a comment on that?
No.
And is that still consistent? Thank you for being more succinct in your summary than I was in my original statement. Okay, so we are on number 9. And staff is recommending that we consider number 9 as part of the fish and wildlife habitat
conservation
area. Thank you. I don't have the acronym completely memorized. And that is to look at improving habitat connectivity within the wetland management area overlay. So this would be kind of come back up, but potentially in a separate part of the code than the wetland management area section. Is that summarizing
yes.
that correctly?
That's correct.
Okay, great. We'll start with Commissioner Collins.
I agree with bringing that up in the separate area of code. I'd like to see included in that the support for the backyard habitat area and include that as a clause of that text.
So how do we incorporate the backyard habitat areas into that section of the code, I think is a request. Did I state
yes.
that correctly?
Thank you.
Great. Commissioner Coleman.
I agree with staff recommendation.
Great. Commissioner Wasserman.
I would agree to advance.
Great. Commissioner Luxembourg.
I agree to advance.
Agree to advance.
Great. Commissioner Lipinski.
We're unanimous, I guess. We don't hear your vote.
We're going to advance, yes. Hold on. I want to take a note on 3-8 before we proceed so that I don't mess this one up. Okay. So we have 3-10 next, which is consider buffer reduction options in combination with, now our memo says preserving and maintaining wetland and buffer functions, but then it goes on to actually discuss enhancement as well. There was a specific recommendation for there's some prescriptive language in here that we may or may not want to consider. I suggest we not focus strictly on the prescriptive language, but we consider whether or not we want to advance the general concept of considering allowing buffer reductions when there's a preservation or enhancement activity associated with that reduction. So with that, I'll start with Commissioner Lipinski. I can't remember who I started with last time.
I agree with staff's recommendation.
Commissioner Islam.
I don't agree with the staff recommendation. And this is primarily because, in my opinion, we are giving incentives and recognizing and acknowledging all the past harm that we have done on critical areas, and in some ways another 10-20 years will go by and we'll say the same thing. Something is already impacted, therefore we should not be working on it. So just on the basis of principle of continuing the degradation, I would not recommend advancing.
So I'd like a clarification of what you just said. So can you maybe provide an example?
I guess I'm struck with your instruction about not looking at that specific language, but specific language would be...
You can use that for your example.
Okay. It talks about existing buffer conditions are degraded such that more than 40% of the buffer is covered by non-native invasive plant species. If we let this move forward, that means we are acknowledging this, and we will be acknowledging in future also similar activities that cause degradation of critical areas. I don't think when we are protecting critical areas, we should be acknowledging those type of activities that have gone in the past. If there is a tighter language to speak about, there is nothing that can be done in certain specific critical areas, and only way to do mitigation is through FEIN, LEW, and other programs, then I could perhaps be convinced. But as it stated, I would not agree because it just validates all the harm being done on the critical areas. Sorry, I wasn't giving any specific example, but these are my thoughts.
Okay, so if I'm understanding you correctly, what I'm hearing you say is, if we've already degraded the buffer area, and then we allow someone to have a lower standard for a buffer, or because they've improved that degraded area back to where it should have been in the first place, right, that's incenting perhaps some of the wrong behavior. Am I understanding that correctly?
Thank you for simplifying this.
Okay. Thank you for helping me clarify. Commissioner Luxembourg.
You know, this one troubles me also, but it would seem as if we have a degradation situation, the only way to make it better is to at least look at this. So at this point, it seems to me we ought to look at it. So I would agree with the recommendation from the staff.
Okay. Commissioner Wasserman.
A clarification on advancement versus decision. And I guess my question is, if we advance this, that doesn't necessarily mean that we're agreeing with its language. It just means that we're going to take a look at it in a little bit more depth, correct?
Correct.
We may decide to look at it in a little bit more depth and go, eh, and step away, right?
Yes.
I vote to advance.
Great. Commissioner Coleman.
I vote to advance.
Commissioner Collins.
I respectfully request that we put enhancement at the front of the paragraph instead of at the end of the paragraph. I agree with Commissioner Islam that improving is the goal.
Okay, so Commissioner Islam, are you comfortable with us having some further discussion about this given the conversation that we've had so far, even though in principle you disagree with the recommendation?
I guess it probably doesn't matter at the end of the day because I have my opinion. I'm not going to sway away from that opinion. But if this is the majority of the commission's desire, I can hold it.
So, yes.
If I may, Chair, we have, at the staff level, we have been thinking a little bit about the kind of perverse incentive that you described a moment ago around some of these regulations. And I think it's one of the things we've identified for our administrative set of recommendations coming forth in June. If I could suggest, I might remind the Planning Commission when we get to your deliberations and just look at how those two sections could interplay.
Yes, I think that's a great suggestion. Thank you. And I do think that if there's ways to word this so that we are not supporting perhaps or giving credit for a low-value, low-function buffer, I think that might be something that we all would be interested in considering. Okay, so we're going to advance 3-10. 3-11. 3-11 actually is not a specific recommendation, and with the Commission's permission, I'd like to suggest that we support the staff's recommendation to note this as a follow-up item, and I would also like to recommend that we actually review all of the follow-up items, whether they've come from a specific recommendation memo or from other public comment that wasn't explicitly noted in a recommendation, and we evaluate which of those we want to recommend the Council consider. Does anybody have any comment on that? Commissioner Coleman.
Who would perform the basin level study?
Gosh, Commissioner Coleman, that would be hard for me to speculate on. The past two studies have been, the project lead has been from Public Works, one of our stormwater project engineers. It would really be a city council decision there, city manager decision.
So it could be in-house staff, it could be shopped out to a consultant?
Pardon me, it likely would be managed by in-house staff and shopped out to a consultant.
And then, so that's a city-driven project that then the city has to figure out how to pay for it.
Correct. It would be a city council budget item, yes, sir.
Any other questions? Okay, so we're comfortable handling this as a follow-up item. Thank you. And with that, we're going to go to 3-12. This is to introduce thresholds to trigger stormwater treatment for redeveloped sites and pervious pollutant generating areas. Staff does recommend advancing this, although I do recall from your presentation there was some question about the pervious polluting areas and how we might manage that. And I want to make sure that I understand that really this is, we have the triggers for new development, but not for redevelopment. Is that the distinction?
That's the primary distinction here. the caution on from my earlier comments,
yes,
is really related to we have an ordinance in place, for example, limiting the use of phosphorus-based fertilizers. I really would want to make sure that it was an enforceable regulation that we presented to the Planning Commission around pervious pollutant-generating surfaces for later discussion.
Perhaps we could consider those somewhat separate. Do we all want to comment on them separately, or do we want to go ahead and comment on them jointly?
All of them, or just 312 and 3?
So no, the pervious pollutant versus redevelopment.
I would support the staff recommendation because it simply catches up with state
all
requirements.
Right. So we're going to comment on both. So because Commissioner Islam has started off, we're going to go in a crazy way and say Commissioner Coleman.
Sorry.
I support staff's recommendation.
Great. Commissioner Luxembourg.
I agree.
Commissioner Collins.
Wow, way out of order.
Keeping you on your toes.
Advance.
Great. Commissioner Lipinski.
I actually have question seven. You mentioned that it has effect on a homeowner's lawn. Explain that to me. Or did I hear you wrong?
No, so the consultant has suggested what the lake management areas do in summary is effectively limit the amount of phosphorus laden stormwater entering Beaver or Pine Lake. And currently we do that primarily through the regulation of new development, where you have more than 5,000 square feet of driveway that's gonna generate phosphorus laden impervious, stormwater. We require that you take that stormwater and clean it before you discharge it into the lake. The consultant has suggested that that might not be enough of a net to capture all the phosphorus that may be affecting the lake. And so they've suggested adding two additional thresholds. One would be for projects that are redeveloping, a house that's torn down and a new house is built, something of that nature. Or looking at the way landscaping is managed within the basin. And I'm using landscaping as kind of the handy example here, because it's the one I have my head around the best, let me put it that way, where in particular you might see a wide area of lawn that's generating a lot of phosphorus-laden runoff through the use of fertilizers into the lake. The concern I have is, at least in that example, we already have a regulation in place that would deal with that particular issue. It just doesn't happen to be in our critical areas code. So we have a limitation within lake management districts on using phosphorus fertilizers on your lawn. It's not in our critical areas code. It's actually a separate ordinance that the city council adopted quite a few years ago now. So part of my recommendation to the Planning Commission is that we evaluate really the practicability of that part, the pollutant generating pervious surface recommendation from the consultant, to see if there's a practical regulation that I can recommend to the Planning Commission and City Council for us to enforce at a later date. Is that explained, Commissioner?
Right, but so right now we're just talking about moving the protection from one part of the code to another part of the code?
And possibly expanding it, and that's really where I need to do some more homework before sure. proposing regulation.
Commissioner Collins has a question.
So Commissioner Luxembourg has a question, then Commissioner Collins, and I would note Commissioner Wasserman has not yet stated his opinion on this item. So go ahead, Commissioner Luxembourg.
I just want to make sure I'm understanding. If I recall in the home business code, we were talking about hazardous materials, And you came back, Evan, and told us that there's somewhere else in the regulations that was adequately covered, so we didn't need to worry about it under the Home Business Code.
Yes, sir.
Is that the same situation that you're talking about here, that there's already a rule, and one of the things you're going to have to look at is whether it makes sense from an administrative standpoint to have the rule in two places?
To have the rule in two places and whether or not that rule needs to be enhanced further.
Okay.
Commissioner Collins.
I would suggest one of the things that staff can report back in this section on pervious surfaces is a drain field in a critical area around a lake and whether or not it's exporting laundry detergents and phosphoruses into that lake. Currently, this would possibly recommend that to the lake management districts.
Okay. Commissioner Wasserman, would you prefer to advance this?
Well, I'm going to ask a question first to Evan. This talks about new pollution generating impervious surfaces. I'm curious if we have, and it talks about things that are, why would we allow it to start with? Why in the building code would you not say these products are not allowable?
So pollution generating impervious surfaces almost by definition include things you drive on. So the most common example in the lake management areas would be long driveways. Mm-hmm. As you probably know, many of the lots on Pine Lake, Beaver Lake are 100, 200 feet long. And even just to put in a 10-foot wide driveway to get down to the lakeside lot.
But now if you do stuff like that, do you not have control of what is approved? I mean, if it's fly ash that's in the mixture of the concrete or if it's whatever the case may be, do you not have the ability to say, all right, this code now states that if you're going to pour concrete in our city, you can't use this material? I mean, it seems like I've heard something like that, that you've generated something that says you cannot use fertilizer with phosphorus in it, right?
Yes.
Why can you not do the same thing with building materials for future new impervious structures?
At least so far, the consultant actually hasn't identified building materials itself as the source for the phosphorus that we're trying to control. It's the stormwater runoff coming off those hard surfaces. In particular, where you have the vehicular traffic, so the cars would be the
easy example. So somebody's generating the phosphorus someplace, though, right? It's not coming out of the rain.
Right, and so we're starting to get into a scientific area where my planning knowledge gets a little
fuzzy. I understand. So that would be my question. So I guess what I'm going to is I'd like to let's see, this is 12.
Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to see more information on it. I'd like to advance it.
Okay. So I would support advancing this as well. We are going to advance 3-12. 3-13 is to specifically reference the TAPE protocol as an alternative for stormwater treatment technologies within the Lake Management District. Staff has recommended that we advance this. I'll start with Commissioner Collins.
Advance.
Commissioner Coleman.
Could you remind us, Evan, TAPE, not Scotch tape, but what is TAPE?
I could until you would have asked me a moment ago. I'm getting flustered at this point. I believe it's total phosphorus, and I'm not sure what the A and the E stands for. But I'd have to get back to the commission on what
does
the actual...
Does any commissioner perhaps know?
I don't have that complete acronym memorized, but it is about treatment technologies for phosphorus removal.
Okay, it's a completely new one for me. But regardless, I agree with staff's recommendation.
Okay, great. Commissioner Wasserman?
I would agree.
Commissioner Luxembourg.
Agree.
Commissioner Islam.
Agree. We don't have a choice. He called you enforce on us.
Yep. Commissioner Lipinski.
If we don't have a choice, I don't even know why we're talking about it, but I agree.
I agree as well. I would like to make a request to staff that in the future for acronyms used in these memos that they actually spell out the words. Thank you.
And watch out for
and I actually have another thing based on what Commissioner Islam said. If we really don't have a choice from ecology, I think we should know that.
That's
and
a great point.
We shouldn't waste any time. God, it's 8:10.
Yes, that's a great point, Commissioner Lipinski. Duly noted. Thank you. All right. Number 14, reference the King County or Ecology Manual procedures to size, analyze, and design stormwater treatment. I do have a question about this, and that is this regulation enforced by our stormwater manual anyway, or no?
No, it is not currently required of all projects.
Only projects over a certain size?
Yes.
What is that size?
I believe it's 7,000 square feet of cleared area.
Okay. So in the lake management districts, we're enforcing the over 7,000 square foot requirements
yeah.
to under 7,000 square foot of disturbed stuff, right?
That is my understanding. I can clarify that distinction for the Plan Commission as part of their review.
Wonderful. Thank you. We'll start with Commissioner Lipinski.
Again, Commissioner Islam tells me we don't have a choice. So if we don't have a choice, I would like to waste no time.
Do you think we have no choice?
I think we shortly will have no choice.
Okay. Does anyone want to have further discussion on this item? Commissioner Collins.
I just for the record, I do think that smaller lots are currently have a bifurcated surface water manual system. This takes away that bifurcation.
For those smaller lots within the Lake Management District, which is what I believe Evan just described.
That's my understanding, yes.
Great. Commissioner Coleman, did you have a comment?
I was just going to note that I like staff's comment here about providing some kind of threshold.
Some threshold for the prescriptive versus site-specific? Mm. Okay, so, and we are confident that that is something that we have flexibility around?
Chair, if I may clarify the choice, no choice, as I understand that particular conversation, we are essentially forecasting what Ecology is going to say as part of their next set of stormwater requirements, which may take effect relatively soon and maybe a few years off.
Okay, so it would probably be inappropriate for us to use a prediction to determine whether or not to further consider this particular item, as we already know what our stormwater manual dictates. So I
believe in the short term, the commission has the option to do the modified alternative that the city staff have recommended. The long-term option we may not have.
Understand, and we're essentially eliminating the long-term, we are eliminating the bifurcation within the Lake Management District is what we're doing.
At least in this regard.
Wonderful. Is that clear for everybody? I don't have an issue with advancing this.
Yes, I want to make a comment. In many of those, we are updating our critical area every 5 or 8 years. In the intervening time, ecology and other federal regulations are coming in place, so we will be in the catching game. If we know something ecology is working on or have started on a pilot scale basis, then if we don't add it, it really means we are not taking advantage of some controls that we could take advantage of for next 5 to 8 years.
I appreciate that. And I do think that we're all saying that we would recommend advancing this. Is that correct? I'm seeing some head nods. Okay, great. So we are advancing 14 as well. 15. Is to create source control best management practice provisions. And staff is recommending advancing this, but I think this is somewhat similar to the previous discussion that we had about the pervious pollutant generating. There's some question about whether or not any additional code may be appropriate or necessary for this. And you would be, if we advance this, you would answer that question for us, correct?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so we'll start with Commissioner Collins.
I would like to see it also address planning for sewers. Most of the ECAs do not have sewers currently. Mm.
Commissioner Coleman.
I agree with staff's recommendation.
Commissioner Wasserman.
I would agree with staff's recommendation.
Commissioner Luxemburg.
Agree.
Commissioner Islam. Commissioner Lipinski.
All I would say is if it doesn't have any practical applications, we don't waste more time than we've already done.
I am very much in favor of addressing things at the source where we can. I think this is a great idea in theory, but to your point, Commissioner Lipinski, the in practice component is rather important. number 15.
Number 16.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're on 16. So. This is actually something that staff has recommended that we include on the follow-up list. So there wouldn't necessarily be any code for, or there wouldn't be any code for us to consider. And similar to the other item that was proposed for the follow-up list, I would recommend that we add it to that list and we review the list of follow-up items and decide which ones we actually want to include in our formal recommendation to council. Does anyone have any comments or questions on this particular item? Commissioner Collins.
The one I have is I'd like to see at the very top of the list reduction in surface water management, surface water. An example of that would be rainwater harvesting could be one of the things to be considered.
So to look at the volume as a component of the percentage.
The volume and then apply the percentage. If you increase the volume, you're decreasing the percentage automatically Solution by dilution is what they used to call it in the 60s.
So that would actually be potentially a change to the language of the code rather than a recommendation that they actually keep an eye on this.
I'm kind of in the follow-up.
Okay.
I don't think we can really do much in code.
Okay. Anyone else? Any other comments?
I have a question. Just maybe I don't understand what's going on here. Is 316 saying, you know, where they're going to compare, does 80% get us any benefit over the 50% current, or is it the other way?
50% removal.
The current requirement in the lake management districts is 80% phosphorus reduction. Is.
Okay. And so then this is saying, will 50% be enough?
Respectfully, Commissioner, I don't believe that's quite the accurate way to describe it. What this is saying is evaluate, so the Department of Ecology adopted a 50% phosphorus removal standard for all of the lakes in the upland area we're talking about, and possibly for Lake Sammamish too, I'm not certain. The phosphorus standard we've adopted in the Lake Management District is an 80% standard. What this recommendation would do is ask the Beaver Lake Management District when they run their phosphorus model to see how well they're performing in removing phosphorus compared to the ecology standard.
All right. Agree to advance.
Great. They don't compare it to our current standard?
I believe, I'm not even certain what our current standard is other than the 80%. I believe it's 50% would be kind of the baseline, and the 80% is our standard.
Okay, so the question is, are we achieving the baseline with the rules that we have in place?
That is my understanding.
Okay, yes. Thank you. Good? Okay. 3-17, so now we're on to the recommendations from public comment. And 3-17 and 3-18 both have kind of a combined response / recommendation from staff, and that is to advance. I will remind the commission that we advanced similar recommendations for streams in our previous meeting. So we're going to cover 317 and 318 at the same time, and I'll start with Commissioner Collins on whether you recommend to advance.
Advance.
Commissioner Coleman.
Advance.
Commissioner Wasserman.
Advance.
Commissioner Luxembourg.
Advance.
Commissioner Islam.
Advance.
Commissioner Lipinski.
It's unanimous.
Great. So we're advancing 17 and 18. 19 is a recommendation that we consider increasing the wetland exemption threshold from 1,000 to 4,000 square feet. And staff is recommending advancing this item. I was going to say something, but I'm going to just leave it at that, and I'll start with Commissioner Lipinski.
I agree.
Okay, Commissioner Islam.
This is the one probably I would very strongly oppose to, primarily because the best available science from the consultant did say that our current regulation is adequate and they are not recommending any increasing the size. Also, taking Commissioner Collins' comment from the last meeting is that it's about the function, it's not about the size. Size has nothing to do with the improvement and disimprovement. Ecology's memo back to city, and thanks, Evan, for allowing me to read some copies of your correspondence. Ecology talked about 1,000 square feet to 4,000 square feet, and here we are all the way going to 4,000 square feet without giving any room for in between. Also, ecologists come and talk about class 3 and class 4 wetlands, not for all the wetlands. And also, ecologists come and again talk about a lot of criteria that city needs to follow before we exempt all of those. So science doesn't bear it. I also don't know how many wetlands in the city we are exempting if we exempt that. In other words, if it is 20% of the city's wetland we are exempting by this exemption, that would be a different story than saying only 1 to 5% of the wetlands we are exempting. So without any of those informations, and not having any iota of scientific evidence that this should be advanced, I cannot say that this should advance any further.
Commissioner Luxembourg.
Commissioner Islam has made a very strong case, a very persuasive one. I'm also mindful of the fact we have a lot of public interest in this. I think it would be fair to at least have it considered so that the questions that Commissioner Islam brings up can be answered. So I'd like to go with the recommendation.
Commissioner Wasserman.
I think I'd like to go with advancing us for exactly the reasons that Commissioner Islam stated.
Commissioner Coleman.
I agree with everything that's been said.
Mr. Collins.
I'd like to see this advanced, but I'd also like to see it treated not as an exemption, but offer a third alternative of combining it with mitigation banking and fee in lieu. I'm not opposed to development of on these sites, but the overall change to the city could be considerable if we don't get banking or fee in lieu to be able to counteract that. So basically, allowing individual citizens to have the same ability that the city has to be able to move wetlands.
So I'm going to echo what I heard, as well as I think something similar to what Commissioner Collins has said. We've already recommended to advance 3-7, which talks about providing additional guidance, both allowances and limitations, concerning small isolated wetlands. I think if we're going to be more refined in how we treat small isolated wetlands, we may be willing to consider reevaluating the size criteria for what we would consider a small isolated wetland. I think that might be an interesting way to incorporate some of these different suggestions. I also want to be clear that we do have a request for the science around an increased size for the definition of a small isolated wetland, as well as some understanding of the scope of this change, how many wetlands this might affect. So did I capture everyone's questions correctly?
Chair.
Madam Chair, I would like the record to reflect that I'm opposing to this. I don't think there is any science. Consultants were very adamant about their evidence that there is no scientific basis for it. There could be a policy basis for it, and policy basis includes all the information that you talked about.
Thank you. Duly noted. Did you want to add something, Evan? I heard someone quietly say chair.
Was I quiet? Yeah. Wow, I gotta practice that. Chair, respectfully, I'm happy to pursue the task that you just identified for staff. I am a little bit concerned because the consultant has noted that there's not a best available science basis here. We can explore the question further. I would suggest the Planning Commission will want to think about identifying a policy basis for this change. If we go down that route, and we'll also explore that question for the commission.
Appreciate that comment. Any Commissioner Collins, did you have a comment?
Do we have more from DOE on what their recommendation was? Their policy recommendation was 4,000 square feet. Is there anything to go against that?
I believe the Department of Ecology made some recommendations, and frankly, I should probably defer to their written testimony. I can provide that explicit to the Planning Commission.
Thank you.
So we'll remind ourselves. Yes, go ahead.
A question. Policy justification can be property rights.
Sure. There are a number of. Yeah. So when we get to that policy basis question, we'll help you line out what specifically you might want to consider.
Okay.
Commissioner Islam?
Madam Chair, the question I have for the staff is that I'm looking at all the other comments, and this is the only comment where staff has a one-liner. Staff recommends advancing this, and there is no input from the staff why, how, when. So on this one, I feel like staff is asking commission to come up with justification, where everywhere else staff has provided us enough recommendation to make our basis.
So as part of the additional information, we would want additional information that supports that recommendation. Is that your request?
Yes.
Thank you. Got that, Evan?
Yes, I believe I do.
Okay, wonderful. And we're on to 3-20, which suggests that we consolidate wetland definitions throughout the code. Staff does recommend advancing this to try to improve the consistency that we have in the code where that makes sense. I'll start with Commissioner Collins.
Approve.
Commissioner Coleman.
I agree.
Commissioner Wasserman.
Approve.
Commissioner Luxembourg.
Agree.
Commissioner Islam.
Advance.
Commissioner Lipinski.
Yes.
So we're unanimous. Having difficulty today. I need more coffee. I apologize to everyone. And we are on our last item, unless we have some additional recommendations from the commission, and that is to increase the allowance for wetlands to be used for stormwater management purposes. And staff is recommending advancing this amendment. I suggest that this one also might be somewhat controversial in nature, but I will start with Commissioner Collins.
I support staff's recommendation. I'm very interested to look at the text on this and to be able to evaluate it. Thank you.
Commissioner Coleman.
I agree with staff's recommendation, and I would like us to consider the cumulative impacts.
Yep.
Commissioner Wasserman.
I'd like to go with staff's recommendation to advance with the caveat that we can look at it and step away if we need to.
Wonderful. Commissioner Luxembourg.
Agree, and I would agree with Commissioner Coleman. I'm interested in the cumulative effect also.
Commissioner Islam.
I would go ahead with the advancement. My comments are cumulative impacts analysis. Are we trading off some functions by adding stormwater function for those critical areas? And I wanted to see extent of the need for stormwater management, additional stormwater management from the city side.
Okay. Commissioner Lipinski.
I agree.
Okay, I also agree to advance. I want to recap briefly that we want some additional information about the cumulative impacts, how using wetlands of certain categories for stormwater purposes might impact their function and value over time, and what is the need to provide this additional stormwater capacity through this mechanism. Yes? All right, with that, I'd like to actually ask the commission, I'll start with Commissioner Lipinski, if they have any other recommendations on these three topics that they would like the commission to consider in addition to what we've already covered. Commissioner Lipinski.
Oh, I don't think we've done enough.
I knew that would be your comment. All right, Commissioner Islam.
I'll rest for the night.
All right, Commissioner Luxembourg.
Nothing to add.
Commissioner Wasserman.
I'm done.
Commissioner Coleman.
I have nothing further.
Commissioner Collins.
I still would like to see the Planning Commission have a meeting at some point in time and take a look at cumulative effects. I think the global planning for the ECA has not been addressed.
So I think there's this kind of uber request to staff that, you know, we kind of step back at some point in our process, and the chair and vice chair will note this request to look at the overall kind of cycle of water that we are affecting in this process. And I recognize it's not just water. Perhaps I should have just said overall, take a holistic view of the regulation. Commissioner Luxembourg.
And I would add to that, not only the holistic view, but the interaction between the various recommendations.
I agree. All right. Cameron, did you want to have any final remarks before we close the meeting? Note you are between us and whatever's after.
I know what's good for the me and the commission, so nope.
Wonderful. With that, I will close the meeting at 8:30 p.m. Thank you all.
And thank you, Caleb, for advertising the ECA.
Yes.